Okay, so welcome everyone for this new edition of the Data Science Colloquium. So it's a pleasure to welcome Florence Delchevelt. Florence is a professor at Telecom Paris, where she's head of the machine learning lab. And she's very well known for all her works on machine learning in general and statistics. Among other things, she was a chair at NeurIPS a few years ago. And today, she will speak about learning to predict complex outputs. Florence, the floor is yours.
Thank you very much, Gabriel. Thank you for inviting me, and sorry for the delay. So today I want to talk about how to predict complex outputs, and I will give you a kernel view on that. And this work has been done with many collaborators, and you can see all of them. And of course, everything I'm going to say is joint work. So first, let's begin by some motivation. Okay. In metabolomics, people are interested by studying smaller molecules known as metabolites. Metabolites are the product of a chemical reaction in living systems. In living systems, and the idea in metabolomics is to identify metabolites, know how much these metabolites play an important role. And indeed, they play a great role. For instance, well, it's a way to define phenotype, and it's a way to know how people with presence or absence of these metabolites can react to some input or output signal in the body. So here we are, it gives us a motivation to tackle the problem of graph prediction. So imagine that you want to help chemists to identify metabolites in a biological sample. And what you do, you take your biological sample, extracted from some living organisms. You take it and put it through a tandem mass spectrometer. You get a mass spectra, which corresponds to Dirac on different masses of atoms. And what you want to do, you want to automatically be able to predict the molecule, the corresponding molecule, meaning that you want to predict a labeled graph. And of course, this is a very complex problem. And what we want to do here is we want to solve it using observation. So we imagine that we have collected pairs of mass spectra and corresponding graph, and we want to solve it in a machine learning way and search for a function that, given X, the mass spectra, gives you a prediction of the metabolite. So to tackle this problem and many other structured prediction tasks, what we are interested in is the following things. We want to propose a generic framework such that if you now change the discrete structure of the output space, you can, of course, again, apply your framework. And you want to do it in a way such that there are not too many components to control. So typically, you are interested by having good tools for realization, and you are also interested to have a computational complexity which is not too high. And of course, the problem of which is the main problem here is the huge size of the output space, okay, and the fact that this output space is finite, okay. So it's not the classical regression problem, and it is even not the multi-class classification problem where you have a reasonable number of classes. Okay, here we talk about 6 million of metabolites which are candidates. So the general framework I'm going to talk about is the following. So what you're going to do, you're going to choose an appropriate representation vector space for complex outputs. We will see that we need a bit more than vector space, but this is the idea. Then we'll regress the output in this representation space, and especially we'll leverage regularization tools. And at the end, because we have not solved the exact problem, we have to come back to the original set of molecules candidates to give finally an answer, and we call this a pre-image problem. There are many ways to apply this generic framework, but we are going to focus on a specific one. We are going to learn functions with value in a Hilbert space. I'm going to call Z, and Z is chosen here to be a reproducing kernel Hilbert space associated to something I'm going to call an output kernel, meaning a similarity between graphs, between outputs. In this work, there are strong links with functional output regression and infinite task learning. I don't think I will have, however, the time to emphasize a lot this link, but at the very end, at the conclusion at least, I will show you that it has also interesting common points with those tools. So let's talk about this approach we have called output kernel regression. And let's restart from the problem. So we want to solve this problem, we want to learn this function. And the typical case we are going to tackle is Y is finite and huge. When I say huge, I'm talking about millions. Okay. So we can set the learning problem as usual, okay, with some given loss function that measure the discrepancy between two graphs, two structured objects. We can also define the true risk as the expectation for a pair of random variables x, y, x being the input, y being the output, an expectation over on this loss. I'm going to call it delta. Okay, so this is the classical true risk minimization problem, and of course, in supervised learning, we observe data, so we assume that we observe ID sample data, finite, and we're going to try to tackle this problem using this given sample and find a good estimator of typically E or the minimizer, depends on delta, of this true risk. So, okay, but there is some problem. Y is really not very nice, okay? And in the literature, you will find various ways to mitigate the discrete nature of the output space. One of the first ideas that people have put in place is called energy-based methods. Energy-based methods, the relaxation consists in learning an energy function or score function, okay, which will apply over input-output pair. So now, instead of learning f of x directly, you are going to solve another problem. You're going to learn j of x, y, maybe with some parameter, could be a neural network, could be many things, okay? But at the end, f of x is equal to the argument of maximum of this score. Meaning that, by design, you have a minimization problem maximization problem inside the classic minimization problem of machine learning, and of course, you pay the cost. When you train your model, you pay the cost of inference, of prediction, because you have to tackle this. Okay. Are there many ways to do that? I won't go into details. Another way is to do end-to-end learning. And end-to-end learning, there are basically two ways to do that. There are people that really refer or rely on probabilistic graphical model to really be able to generate Y directly, okay, by sampling some model, and they backpropagate an error through that, okay? Or you can directly softenize the argmarks, and which is a recent works of many people, Pilula, Blondel, and very, very, very nice works indeed, where you are going to take an argmax as a softenization. Okay, in fact, you are going to regularize, in fact, the idea of maximum. And by the way, argmax will be nice, and you will be able to define a gradient. Another method is the method I'm going to present you, which is still, I think, interesting, and maybe that can be combined with the second one. But it belongs to the huge family of surrogate regression. And here, I'm going to specifically talk about surrogate methods that we can imply in practice. I will talk about this idea of output kernel regression, an idea that was present in the kernel dependency estimation of Cortes and colleagues, without the notion of operator valued kernels, but still it was there, in several works we did, and also in Kadri's work. So let's get the intuition, okay? What I'm going to do, instead of learning a function f, okay, I'm going to use a feature map psi that take elements of y and send them to some Hilbert space then. And so now, instead of learning f, I will first solve a regression problem learning h, and then, of course, I will have a pay to price when I want to predict, and I will use some decoding function. So you have three things to do. You have, of course, to define this Hilbert space and psi, and you have to solve the regression problem. And at the moment you solve the regression problem, of course, you do not pay the price of the inference because you have no argmarks, okay, in the expression of the problem, okay. And then when you want to predict, well, there is nothing free. You have to pay the price, and again, you will have this pre-image or decomposition problem to solve. So you have to take h of x, this prediction in the feature space then, and you have to come back to the original space by solving some typical problem of pre-image. Okay? So far, so good. So typically, the idea of using a kernel here, a kernel between the output, like kernel between graph, okay? It's, of course, to encode the similarity between the structured object. And also, if you want, it's a bit the same idea as using the kernel trick in the input space, if you know support vector machine, kernel regression. But here, you do in the other way. You use it in the output space, okay? And a natural, of course, the usual suspect behind the kernel is the canonical feature map. So to some object y, you are going to implicitly associate a function k dot y, a function of one variable, which is an element of an Hilbert space hky, which is a reproducing kernel Hilbert space associated to this kernel. So this is interesting as a method, first because it allows infinite dimensional embedding and not restricted to finite embedding, so you have the power of the kernel trick, and also because there is a huge literature, mainly rather old literature, let's say 10 or 15 years ago, about structured objects, kernels between structured objects that were used in problems where the inputs were structured. So you have kernels between rankings, okay? So between permutation. You have kernels between nodes in a graph. You have kernels that apply on images. If you want to do, for instance, image completion, and you have kernels between graphs, as we have in our problem. Of course, there is a constraint, however, to benefit from the kernel trick, not all the losses are suitable. So I won't go to talk a lot about that, but just for you to know, a kernel between molecules is typically a kernel that applies on fingerprint, molecular fingerprint. I just make a parenthesis here. A molecular fingerprint is typically a way to encode the structure of a molecule using a dictionary of substructure. Okay, and you are going to describe your graph with the presence or the absence of some substructure in your dictionary. It could be subsequence of the labels and the nodes. It could be various things. But typically, once you have this huge representation, very sparse, say of Y, you can then apply any kernel, like for instance the Gaussian kernel. Okay, I'm just close the parenthesis. So the questions I was asking is, of course, not all the loss will be possible. And so what we're going to do first, I'm going to recall what we want to do with output kernel regression. Then I will give you an intuitive idea of what we have done without, without relying on statistical theory. And then I will show how it fits or it meets some statistical theory about surrogate approaches. Okay, so let's come back to our problem. So now we have this idea, okay? What we're going to take as a loss here is typically a loss that is based on this canonical feature map, psi of y, okay? So behind this there is a kernel, okay? And for the moment, we are going to assume that we know how to compute that, okay? And L apply on this embedded y and y prime with psi, okay? And the idea of solving this problem with a surrogate regression problem is to try to search a function that minimize this true surrogate risk, if I can say, okay? And of course, again, you can look at the empirical counterpart, regularized or not, and you can try to find some function, some estimate hn. And with this estimator, you can build your predictor fn, okay? And typically, the decoding function that we will use will take this form, okay? So once we have said that, we have all these questions, of course, to answer. Loss, hypothesis space, learning algorithm, Andol pre-image, and what are the statistical guarantee, okay? And before answering this question, I just want to take the angle of practical point of view, because it is usually the point of view that we favor in our group at first. And the idea is that, okay, look at the problem. You need some conditions, okay? There is some necessary conditions, so if you want to use these tools, L must be computed using only inner products, okay? That's, of course, a simple thing, but okay, you need to check that. The second thing, which is more a sufficient condition, if you have an estimated model HN which takes a form of a weighted, an average mean, weighted mean of psi yi, okay? Then it's relatively nice, okay? Because you have a combination of psi yi, and that you know that you know how to combine to compute inner product, and this is a good shape for our model. It's a good candidate. I'm not saying this is the only one, but if our H takes this form by design, it has an output in the right space. By design, when I will use it in my prediction function, fn of x, when I will decode this, I will assume with my first condition that I'm able to compute all the inner product because h of n of x is just a linear combination of the training output data. Okay? And very naturally, at this stage, you can be interested by non-parametric models like tree-based approach, k-nearest neighbor, kernel methods. So just a simple example to show you that you don't need to have kernel in the input space in this approach. You can completely have another kind of representation for your inputs, still relying on a kernel representation for the output, and use, for instance, a very simple kernelization of regression trees. So as you know, a tree is built as providing in regression an average weighted average of the output training data. Okay, here it will be the same, except that our training data are in the reputing kernel Hilbert space HKY associated to Y. And the idea is that when you learn the regression tree, you learn how to make the link between one data and one leaf of the tree, okay? And because everything is square loss, so the loss that you want to greedily minimize is a square loss, meaning that when you want to find a split in the tree, you want to maximize the reduction of the embedded output empirical variance, okay? everything can be computed using the kernel trick, you are fine. And of course, there is only at the end the problem of the pre-image that, of course, you have to solve. Again, no magic. Okay. So just to tell you, we used this long time ago to solve a problem with a protein-protein interaction network, and even with other method that I will show you, we also be able to propose proteins that play a role in fibrosis. Okay, there are nice applications behind that. What is really important, and maybe I didn't say it, this work completely started from practical questions from biologists and chemists, in the sense that they ask a question that we could not answer with classical models, and then we say, okay, to answer these questions, we need something more general. Okay? So, okay, you can do regression trees, you have this nice combination, it's a non-parametric model where the training output data, of course, play a role as are parameters of your system. There are interesting things with kernel regression trees, with trees in general, but for instance, they cannot be used for semi-supervised learning, they are not differentiable, they are not smooth, there are plenty of things that you may want to do, you cannot do with tree. So now let's take another point of view, a theoretical point of view. Okay, you propose something, you can tell me, you can say, okay, you propose something which is a surrogate approach, but am I sure that solving this surrogate approach, I come back to what I want, which is a minimizer of the true initial target risk, okay? So the way we can see the problem, so imagine that you perfectly solve the problem. You have H star, which is a minimizer of this expectation, okay? So Hx of x is trying to reach psi of y, okay? You solve this regression problem, okay? Perfectly, okay? And now you want to decode. Okay, and you get some function which is the decoding of this H star of x. Okay. And of course, the question is, well, can I compare this with the true minimizer, or with the minimizer, sorry, of the true risk? Okay, that's a good question. And this is a question that colleagues Siliberto, Rudi, and Al have looked at in a few papers for now several years, and they proposed a nice framework called structured encoding loss function that stated and studied general condition on Y and on losses to get Fisher consistency, and also they derived some statistical property of the estimator like consistency. So the idea is the following. Be careful, so now I'm entering into this new framework, and what does the framework say? If I'm going to define first the property of being self, okay, delta, a loss between y on y, is said to be self if it exists a separable Hilbert space, I'm going to call it f, a feature map phi from y to f, and a bounded linear operator a, on f, such that for all pair y prime in y, your delta loss can be written as the inner product between this feature vectors transformed by a. Okay. When delta has this property, when a loss has this property, then you can apply a surrogate approach, okay? The intuition is that when you have this linear form, in fact, you will be able to extract a regression problem for H. And this regression problem will be the regression problem with the square loss, okay? And basically, what we have here, we have a nice theorem that say that if delta satisfies the self property, with the definition of the decoding function as it is here, we have two things. first, the true risk of the perfect, the decoding of the perfect surrogate regressor is equal to the true risk of the minimizer of the original problem. So meaning that if you do that, if you apply this surrogate approach and a true risk framework, it's perfectly good. You have the same level of quality for your predictor. Other thing which is interesting, if I changed my notation and that's another. Okay, sorry. If you look at the, so here it's the risk of D compose H compose with D, okay, and of course the risk of D compose with H star. Sorry, change my notation. Sorry for that. Okay, and what is good here is that you will have so for any H. Okay, so what you have here, so you have something interesting that the discrepancy between the two risks of H, how much for a given predictor H you fail to be close to H star, you will find it here. Okay? So, it's good. Okay, I was, sorry, I was a little bit, this is perfect. Okay, so, which is what we expect. Okay, we expect that if I'm doing well in the regression problem, of course, it impacts and it controls how I'm doing well at the end for my complete predictor. Okay? That's interesting how it is related to our problem. You can imagine that, okay, this is not exactly phi m psi, not exactly. So, in fact, there is a trivial case where it coincides perfectly. Okay? It's a case where in my output canal regression, I take k of equal to a constant, typically 1, okay? I choose a kernel like that, okay? For instance, you can take the Gaussian kernel. And the idea is that, as a loss, you take the loss induced by psi, okay? And when we are going to compare directly h of x and psi of y, you take the square loss in the RKHS hky, which is your space where you embed your output. Okay, if you take this, you perfectly fit this this cell framework. Of course, when you compute the decomposition, nice things happen. So, finally, while you were trying to minimize the distance between psi y and xi, finally it's minimizing minus the inner product because you don't need the inner product with psi y. Psi y by psi y is a constant, okay? And h of x, of course, x being fixed, you don't need as well as the square norm of h of x. What is interesting here is that, okay, the two frameworks coincide, so we are happy because we have freely, without proving anything, we inherit some theoretical property. But there are things interesting to say. So first, self applies to many y and losses. And typically, there is something interesting you have to catch here, is that when the y is finite, you can in fact always find a function phi that that applies here, and you can always prove that any loss when y is finite is itself. But the phi you take is not very interesting. It's a phi which is one hot encoding. Okay, if I have 6 million molecules, I'm not going to do that. Okay, but still the property holds. Okay. And what is very interesting, there are many other distances, including optimal transport distances, distance on manifold, that will have this self-property. But what I want to emphasize here, it's not because you have this property and you can prove a nice theoretical bound on your excess risk. Remember the difference between the risk of H composed with D and the risk of the best one, the F star. Okay, it's good to have this nice results. But what is important is that you have to handle and to apply your algorithm on something that is also interesting in practice. Maybe you have bounds, but they are not enough tight. Okay, so at some point you will see that the two frameworks will divide. Okay, but it's really important to have that in mind. I'll come back to that. So I don't know the time. Maybe I'm going to check the time because I'm going to quickly try to give you an idea of when we use square laws. Okay, this is a no. Okay, thank you. That means I'm late. I'm going to talk briefly about square laws, an extension also that Luc Brogamot, one of my PhD students, did, by the way, in collaboration with Alessandro Rudi. And we are going to go behind square laws because this is much more fun. Okay, so let's start just by saying how we are going to handle the problem. Okay, so we are going to use a hypothesis space where we can handle this function with values in Hilbert space. Okay, and for that, we are going to not to use trees, but we're going to use kernels. Okay, kernels in the input space as well. So what we need to learn function with Hilbert values, with value in Hilbert space, we need operator valued kernels. Okay. And there is an interesting line of theoretical work from Pedrix to the work of Carmeli, for instance, and De Vito. Okay, and in the machine learning community, these methods were really shared by Micheli and Pontil in 2005 when they were interested by generalizing multitask learning. So the idea is as follows. If you know already what is a kernel K, a similarity which has nice property, a scalar kernel which has nice property, being positive, you can, as you know, build a reproducing kernel Hilbert space, okay, that enjoy the reproducing property, which is really nice, meaning that when you play with f of x, it's as if you are playing with a linear model, okay? And with operator valued kernel, it's completely symmetric. It's really parallel, okay? The idea is now your kernel will be an operator on the output space, okay? And by the way, with this definition, we'll be able to have a function that are vector valued in the Hilbert space. And you have similar property. I'm not going to go into details, but you will find the equivalent of the Arrangeant theorem and the reproducing property you get also. Just a trick, if you want to see what you have, take just the example of having as a output space RD, okay, you have then a matrix valued kernel. If you take a matrix which is identity, well, you recover the trivial case of having D independent model, okay. But if you put in the matrix A some information about the dependency between the outputs, then you have a very much more interesting tools because, as you know, when choosing the right kernel, you also choose the way to regularize, to make regularization, for instance, during learning. And choosing K implies that you're going to, by choosing A, choosing the way you want to regularize the function relying on the dependency and the output, which is really interesting. Okay? In the case of Hilbert space and infinite dimensional Hilbert space, then typically the AKHS, then what you are going to mainly use here, it's a kernel which is an identity operator in the output space times a scalar-valued kernel. And contrary to the finite dimensional case, it's a very interesting kernel. In fact, if K, the scalar kernel, is universal, big K will be also universal. So this is very interesting. It's really not at all prevent the use of this kernel. It's a very general kernel. It's a way to be able to predict in the right output space. Okay. So we have a Pointer theorem, and you see there is a problem with the Pointer theorem. It's not enough informative for us. Okay, there is a Pointer theorem, but I have a finite number of parameters, but each parameter is in an infinite dimensional space, so that's not nice. Okay. So of course, there is one very simple case where we can tirer notre épingle du jeu, we can be successful, is a problem where you do kernel retrogression. Okay, you can do kernel retrogression, applying your Pointer theorem, having a unique minimizer, write the problem, enjoy your closed form, okay, and rewrite your kernel regression tool, okay, as this nice linear combination of psi y with a closed form for this function beta of x. Okay, in this case, you retrieve something called kernel dependency estimation of Cortes and colleague, which were defined without using the notion of operator-valued kernel, which help a bit to study things in theory and even in generalization, the approach. Okay. So yes, you can do that, and you are fine with that, which are relatively easy. Of course, you may argue that, oh, closed form, I don't like it. It will be a bit heavy to compute. That's true, of course. You can, in fact, rely on the same trick that you use in a kernel retrogression, like with a niche based on a random Fourier feature if your kernel is a translation invariant, or using Nystrom approaches and more generally sketching. Okay. But I want just to show you something you can do also to improve things. So if you have this idea that in a least square regression, you are, for instance, maybe used to think about a low rank solution, okay? Well, you can try to design low rank approaches also, but considering the output space. Okay, so, okay, we are very happy with this solution, but maybe do we want to improve it? Maybe do we want to improve it not only during the training phase, but also in the test phase, okay? And the small problem we have solved with Luc Brogamot is the following. So imagine that you assume that there is some structure in your solution H star of X, okay? There is, in fact, okay, the value is in a Hilbert space there, which is here our HKY, okay, but assume that there is some structure, okay, and maybe you can apply some operator P, okay, for having the idea that you want to reduce the rank of the solution, okay, and you cannot solve this problem, but you can replace the problem by using the closed form solution, the proxy for the H star, okay, and try to solve the problem in equation 5, where you search for p hat given some predefined rank p. You will maybe choose by cross validation at some point, okay, and try to see if, however, you could find again to reduce a little bit the complexity of the solution at some point, but finally solve the solution in dimension p. Okay, I won't tell you the nice results that Luc proposed, but there is very interesting things, very parallel to what we have in general. So we will have source conditions that apply on the output. So we leverage the structure you have in the output gram matrix, and you will be able, in fact, to reduce the complexity. It's not that interesting, finally, in training, but in prediction, it's very interesting, and you can reduce really the testing time. Okay, I won't go into the details of the numerical results. I just want to tell you that if you do this approach with input kernel, you can find a nice kernel for your mass spectra in our practical problem of molecule prediction, okay? And you have nice results, very nice results, in fact, compared to a neural network learned as an energy-based model. And the interesting thing is that most of the neural network approach are usually completely devoted to one specific task, in fact, and are, let's say, optimized for that task. And here, we can get a similar kind of results, rank of the approaches, when we change the problem, like label ranking, image completion, things like that, for as far as we have the good input features. And that's interesting. Just a small thing, top K accuracy, it's really important for a very difficult problem. You want to retrieve graph, it's very, very difficult to retrieve the true graph. So what you do, you can also propose the fifth first best prediction, and you can look if there is or not the true graph in this set of K equal 5, okay, and then you have more interesting results. It's important to know that even with K equal to 10, K equal to 20, even 50, it's interesting for chemists. At least this is what they say. And maybe I should also have said that currently Ridge IOKR is a best method that wins the international challenge in the domain. I know I'm late. I want to give you a small idea of what we can do. Okay, I want to give you a small idea of what we can do with, let's say, more interesting losses than square loss. I love square loss, there is no problem, but sometimes you may, and this is the case in the graph molecule prediction problem, you may have outliers in the output space. Okay, and you are not so happy with the square loss. You will like typically use a loss which induces the robustness, okay, such Uber loss, okay, for instance. Or you may also be interested to have a sparse solution, okay? A sparse solution in terms of data, of course, because we are in non-parametric modeling, so the sparsity applies really on the number of data, number of training data you're going to leverage, okay? So that's why it can be interesting to have this idea of going behind square loss. And of course, what we are interested in, we would like to have the same nice results having a way to express the solution as a linear combination of the psi yi. Okay? So we need a more powerful operator theorem. Okay? So these are losses which are presented in 1D and 2D, just to give the idea of similar to what you have in 1D, in a scalar case, in a finite dimensional case, or in a Hilbert space case. You can be interested by these loss, which have a very nice thing. They are always, they can be written as infimal convolution with balls in with different kind of balls in the space and balls, and that's very interesting. So here an example, okay, for instance, epsilon sensitive loss, okay, and what we are interested is to go further this theorem, okay? And typically, to do that, we need more assumption, which is not here. You need convexity, okay? So you need convexity, okay? And once you have convexity, you can rewrite your problem using Fenchel-Legendre transform, and you get a problem that still needs to be to be solved. Needs to be worked a little bit, okay, to get a nice solution. So here, with a slight abuse of notation, L will be applied on the difference of the output, and even Li of y will be the difference L applied on yi minus y. Okay. So again, let's think what we need in practice. We need to have Fenchel-Legendre transform L star that can be computable, we can calculate in practice. And also, we have always the same problem. Our dual variables are infinite dimensional. So we need to do something. And what we'd like to find a parameterization of the alpha I, okay, typically a linear combination of the training output data. Okay? And in fact, this is the work of Pierre Laforgue and Alex Lambert and colleagues who been interested in extending this idea that we have nicely in the square loss and finding conditions on kernels and on the losses such that we can have this nice Roperator theorem where now the solution expresses with a linear combination, not only on k dot xi, but also on the z, zj. And here I give you the theorem in a general form, not only for output space, which is the RKHS, but more general for Hilbert space, because it will also serve us in the case of functional output regression. So there is a nice, there is mild condition. It's not the, that, that complex to get them, but what you have to know is that if you take the span of the ZG, the observed output training data, this set has to be invariant by your kernel, okay? And let's say all the losses I presented to you build on an infimal convolution, they will have a nice property, and we will be able to derive this solution. The proof of the theorem only rely on optimization arguments, and there is always two ways to solve to prove a Roperator theorem, and this is on the side of not functional analysis, but on the side of optimization. Okay, so okay, now you are happy because your model is in the good form. Okay, so interestingly, this leads to a optimization problem, at least for the three losses we consider that we can handle. Okay, and you can show that the big matrix W that you want to find will be the solution of problems that boil down to a classic problem by a bit of trick of calculation. So in fact, what you have, remember, you have kx, you have ky, gram matrix for input, gram matrix for the output. This is in the nice case of, I should have said that, separable identity value kernel, okay, and you take your ky, you apply Chulesky decomposition, you get v transpose. You do the same for you also. You are going also to decompose kx, and you are going to write this problem after this decomposition, okay? In you recover structured norm. You are recovering problems where you have convexity and the non-smooth penalty can be handled with the projective gradient, okay? So here, typically the generic algorithm, okay? I'm not going to go through the results, but there are different results with a different other size of the data or size of the candidate molecules that you consider. So there is a trick that everybody is using, that when you consider the pre-image problem, you are going to look at a limited set of candidates, okay? Because in the mass spectral problem, in fact, you know the total mass of the molecule, so you can use it to filter out some candidates. So there is some trick, okay? And you may see some differences between the previous results, but it's always a case of, did we consider the same candidate state? Okay, but basically, let's say it works well and it has some interesting things. A point which is important, here we do not fit the cell framework here, so we do not get, not inherit the same, the consistency, and there is something to do else to show that. In practice, our estimator is not the same as the estimator that you. The self property is not here, cannot be applied. Okay. There is some other interesting things, like we can have generalization bound, for instance, in the context of algorithm stability. You can do go deep. Okay, you can say that everything in the from the input to the last layer, it's neural network. Okay, your preferred convolutional neural network, for instance, you have images or even the even the mass spectralized nice 1D convolutional network could work fine, and just the last layer, you have this last layer with output kernel regression. We did that for another problem, like kernel autoencoder, again with Pierre Lafog, and we now do that for structural prediction with Tamim El-Ahmad. And I want now to conclude, and I am looking at Gabriel. Okay, so I'm going to conclude, give some perspective, and if you have questions about the link with the functional output regression, I will answer to questions. So there are some nice perspectives on this work. First, of course, at least for people who like solve application, we need to scale, to continue to our effort to scale up these approaches. In fact, we can expect approximation. So we did define operator valued random Fourier features. When the kernel is really translation invariant, it's nice, which is not the case here, as you can imagine with the fingerprint. You can also use sketching Nyström and more generally sketching, and this is a line of research we are investigating. It's very interesting. So, of course, you need two approximations: okay, approximation of your input kernel, approximation of the output kernel. So there is a nice link to leverage the two approximation. Then, of course, in this case, you boil down to a finite dimensional problem. Okay, so you have not the same interest for the method I showed previously. And of course, in general, if you look at this approximation by feature map of kernels, it's really important also to think about dictionary, decomposition into dictionary, much more, over, of course, beyond the case of random Fourier features. And this is also a line of research we have investigated with prediction learning, where dealing with a dictionary of output function, especially learning it. This is also another thing that, of course, is cannot be specifically linked with a kernel. I mean, we don't need to use kernel in this case. But kernel learning, it's important. Output kernel learning, of course, it's also very interesting. And input kernel can be solved, as I said, with a deep hybrid architecture. And finally, in fact, I cannot use the same argument of the cell framework in the with the losses I divided. Okay, so it's a tricky part. I mean, it's not that self does not apply; it applies. Okay, well, you remember why is finite in my problems. Okay, it's just that the loss and the estimator I'm building does not exploit the feature map that is behind most of the proofs of self. So we need to look directly at the problem of structural prediction with losses which are have not the nice property of square loss, and there is a gap here to fill. Additional thought, all this literature about embedding outputs is also used in other problems like open set recognition, zero shot, few shot learning, where you have millions of classes, okay, or you have classes that you never encounter during training phase, and you come up with new classes at the test phase. Of course, in this case, you cannot rely on a classifier with a fixed predefined number of classes at the beginning. It's more interesting to embed all the possible classes in a nice representation space and use a similar trick. And this is what we did with Moussa Djerab. And people are doing the same, of course, in the case of neural network, where they try to learn, in this case, they learn output representation that they reuse for instance, in zero-shot learning. The last word is you have noticed everywhere that we have, it was especially emphasized in the square loss. You have noticed we have barycenters everywhere, okay? We are leveraging, Did I write it? No, maybe not. Okay. When you solve this problem, okay, maybe I wrote it. Okay, I'm going just to tell you that. Sorry. When you look at this problem, okay, and you remember the nice form of h of x, okay, remember the h of x is an average, the linear combination of the psi of yi, and here you have a nice problem of finding a barycenter of the psi yi, okay, weighted by some weight that depends on x, okay. So of course, there is nothing prevent to go for other kind of losses. And this is what we did with Claude Bogamot and Rémi Flammary. And we look at fused Gromov barycenter that are able to deal with labeled graph as well, with a strong interest. In this case, if you solve a similar problem, you will be able by design to compute barycenter, so to compute representation of label graph with even the possibility of having the number of nodes that varies due to the nice property of Gromov-Wasserstein distance. And I think it's a fruitful idea to think again about these approaches. In general, non-parametric approaches are approaches that are computed using a weighted average of the output data, and alternatively, that can be seen as, of course, barycenter, conditional barycenter. Okay, and I think this is a nice direction that we want to continue to investigate. In terms of codes, it's almost done. So we have many codes for all the approaches. Everything is in GitHub, no problem. But we have nearly finished a general scikit-learn compatible library, which encompasses all our model, from a kernel ridge to a robust loss to trees to deep version. Okay. And please tell me if you are interested to test it. We'll have in the next 15 days a sequence of tests, and Rémi will participate. Just to be able to use these tools in a very general way. And we are helped by a group of engineers at iParis, which is a center for AI in Institut Polytechnique de Paris. And thank you very much.
So, time for questions. So, you didn't talk much about the decoding aspects of the training.
That's true.
Program.
Yeah.
So, how hard is it, for instance, on the type of question you are addressing?
Yeah, no, that's a very interesting thing. So the pre-image problem is a nice optimization problem as it is. It's usually, NPR and difficult problem. So there are different ways to cope with that. Like in other social output prediction problem, in fact, nobody look at a candidate on the full Y. First, we restrict on a candidate set which depends on X. Okay. And second, there is no general way to solve the decoding problem, in the sense that for different cases I have rapidly talked about, like ranking, tree prediction, things like that, you may have a specific nice way to solve the problem. Sometimes even with the help of heuristic or of different kind of, let's say, more classical AI algorithm. So to be honest, it's not a problem we really focus on. So we do relatively simple things on that. As you see, I wanted to show you this. There is obviously a price to pay. A price to pay when we decode. Okay, and it's really important. In the case of reduced rank algorithm, this is really the main interest of that, leveraging p, which is of course generally very much smaller than n, because there is indeed structure on this output gram matrix. So this is one way to solve the problem in a generic way. Otherwise, most of the pre-image problem are solved a bit specifically, given the kind of kernels you have.
You show at the end, they integrate the decoding, and after you test on some classical.
Yeah, kernels. Yeah, that's it. Yeah.
Some questions?
So thank you, Florence, for this really nice talk. I was wondering something at the end, when you have the robust losses.
Yeah.
So you manage to reformulate it,
yeah,
like with some kind of magic to group lasso optimization problem here. Yeah. So that's funny, because if you're sparse with group lasso on the W hat, then you're going to be low rank on omega, no? Doesn't you give some kind of structure on the omega hat?
Yes, so that's true that we copied with W, which is not exactly omega, okay? So first of all, as you know, all these losses induce sparsity by the B of dualization, so it makes your sparsity term applied, and in this so you have so your question is about the final form of omega.
Yeah, because
yeah.
It's funny if it's low rank because of the robust loss.
Yeah, but you have the idea that by working on the structural sparsity of W, you succeed to reduce the rank of the big omega.
Yeah.
So that's. You want more?
No, that's really interesting.
Yeah,
I
yeah, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
And I have a second question. Is that okay, Gabriel?
Yeah,
okay.
Okay.
So this is more. Philosophical question. You talk at the beginning about fingerprints.
Yeah.
And so you have those vectors that represent your complex molecules.
Mm.
And I was wondering if, so it's philosophical because it's kind of bypass all the maybe the kernel method. Do people try to regress
to
our fingerprints?
For us, it's a linear kernel. Of course, we tried it. Yeah, yeah.
It
work,
work as well as
kernels? Largely, yeah.
Okay.
It works not that bad, but it works less than. So, for instance, Céline Brouard in a paper in bioinformatics really check every kinds of output kernels, okay, and specifically this one, linear one on the. No, there is an interest still to do a Gaussian kernel on this fingerprint. And we also tested other more involved kernels, the kernel that, for instance, studied in the group of Karsten Bockwart And but still, this fingerprint with Gaussian kernel works very nicely.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. So I think we can thank Klaus for a very nice talk.